Movie tie-in games are mostly garbage. The quality ranges from bargain bin shovelware to holiday scams. And why shouldn't you, as a movie studio, dip your toes into the games industry when it clearly makes a lot of money? It makes sense. Unfortunately, movie studios don't care. The story in most of those games, even though they try to follow the movie, are either completely different or an alternate version of the original. The gameplay, since everything has to be done super quickly, ranges from subpar to subterranean. And in most cases, everything is one generation behind, be it in the graphical department or gameplay one. Nevertheless, sometimes we get actual good tie-in games that everybody immediately forgets about, like the Terminator Resistance game, or that one Madagascar game, or that one Treasure Planet game, or you get the point. Recently, Netflix has announced an interest in dipping their toes into the games industry, and while I think they will probably just make a bunch of high predatory low quality mobile games, we have seen some higher quality stuff with the Stranger Things games, for example. It seems like in that case, someone actually gave a shit, because just hiring a random studio to develop a random game would have probably not worked out. Imagine trying to hire id Software to make a visual novel, or trying to hire Telltale Games, if they were alive, to make a fast-paced shooter. It is important to get the right studio with the right toolset to develop the game that fits the feel of the movie or the series. And that seems to be the case with Kate Collateral Damage, developed by Ludwig Studios, the same people who previously made Arcane, the arcade slasher. The game is fairly simple. Grab a weapon, grab a gun, and slash through enemies. If you played Arcane before, you would basically have the same experience, but with a few improvements and extra tidbits. Like in Arcane, you have to go through waves of enemies until you reach a boss. After certain waves and after the boss, you get temporary upgrades, and those can range from more weapon durability to infinite ammo when you first enter a room. I feel like I shouldn't call this a roguelite, but you do go through the same stages in different order every time, you have upgrades during run that will help you out, you get permanent upgrades when you come back to the base, and you start from the beginning every time you die. So, while it doesn't feel like a roguelike to me, it probably is. There are also special abilities that basically boil down to being a stun, but I never used them or needed them, so I think they are pretty useless. While Kate looks different from Arcane, the enemies look pretty similar. We still have the normal foot soldiers, gunners and tanks, but now they have more weapons and every boss is unique. Following the movie, we have a tutorial section with Kate setting up an assassination of Annie's dad, with us finally executing the kill. The tutorial section is really quick, and while the movie intro is also pretty short, it handled things a bit more differently. The movie opens up with an overhead shot of Osaka, identifiable by that Ferris wheel and that weird-looking building in the background. You might miss it the first time, but there's a pink truck in the middle of the screen, and in the background there's a faint jingle going on. As we zoom in towards the truck, the jingle becomes louder, and the truck becomes more visible, until we're basically in front of the truck, and the song is very clear to hear. We cut for a few seconds to a scene where a car drives by two guards, and important here is that the music cuts out entirely. Finally, we see the truck parking somewhere, and the tune is back on. The scene switches to boxes with the music still going on in the background. As the camera pans from right to left, we see guns on the wall, and as the camera turns around, we see two people talking to each other. As the jingle slowly fades away into the background, these two figures talk to each other about the next mission. These are simple techniques, but I think they are used very effectively here. The volume of the music is signaling where we are. Even when we change to a completely different location that doesn't look like the thing we expected, our brain still makes the leap because of the background music. In this case, we make the connection that these two people are inside of the truck because the jingle is still going on in the background as the camera pans towards them. This will be one of the better examples of filmmaking, because while I enjoyed the movie, there are certain things that I really don't like about it. Anyways, we soon find out that this is Kate, a trained assassin, played by Mary Elizabeth Winstead, also known as Ramona Flowers, from Scott Pilgrim vs. the World.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And this is V, or Varric, her handler, played by Woody Harrelson, known from one of my favorite movies,
Defender.
From their exchange, they seem to be very close to each other, to the point that V knows what kind of drink Kate prefers, handing her Boom Boom Lemon as she leaves the truck. Kate walks up to the two guards we've seen before, and I don't know what those guards were guarding exactly and why they were conveniently in front of an open shed that can be closed very easily, but it seems like the movie doesn't care either. After killing the guards and hiding them in a convenient shed, Kate climbs up a building, prepares for sniping, and evades her target. As she's about to shoot, a kid gets out of the car. Kate reports that there's a code 5 on the scene, and the command voice, which we'll never see by the way, commands her to take the shot anyways. Kate repeats,
"Hold on, there's a kid here."
Kate might be a ruthless assassin, but she doesn't want to kill in front of children, goddammit. Which is kind of weird if you think about the rest of the movie, where she will be killing a lot of people in front of kids, but like I said, there are things I don't like about the movie. Despite Kate's hesitation and their own breach of protocol, Command Voice confirms that she's supposed to take the shot, and she shoots the target in the neck and in the head. We see the kid holding her dad, screaming for help, and a reaction shot from the main bad guy of the movie, as we will later find out. Why are those people here? What are they doing? What is this meeting? Were the two guards just randomly there guarding nothing? Or what were they guarding? These are just some of the questions I had when I first watched the movie, and by the way, none of those questions will be answered. I think the game handles the action parts of this scene better. There are more guards to confront, the space is a little bit more believable even though you get respawning weapons, and while I still don't know what they are doing, the bodyguards are actually guarding a body. I like the opening of the movie more, but I like the action part of the game more. Weirdly enough, the part of the movie that I think handles the intro better and will probably translate into gameplay easier is completely cut from the game. In the movie, we cut to 10 months later, Kate is on a run, sees a nice looking dress, and right after a happy mother and child pair. Then quickly cut to Kate talking to V, where they discuss the Osaka incident. Here's the first time we hear the term collateral damage, which turns out to be the subtitle for the Kate game. It seems that killing in front of children was Kate's tipping point. She has been killing people as far as she can remember, and so she just wants to retire and have a normal life. And so Kate decides that this is her last job and that she wants out. After that, to take her mind off things and prepare for the next hit, Kate dresses up nicely in the dress we spotted earlier, goes to a restaurant, takes a guy back home, and does the devil's tango as you do before an assassination.
Nice.
For some reason, Kate memorizes this guy's address, maybe out of habit, maybe out of distrust, and as she receives the next mission via phone, she sends the guy away, leaving him money and basically treating him like a prostitute. Which is funny to me because of this guy's reaction. We then move to the rooftops where Kate is setting up her last kill. In the background, we can see scenes from Tokyo Ghoul, and I don't know if it was intentional or not. In Tokyo Ghoul, a guy gets turned into a ghoul and refuses at first to kill humans to survive. He gets captured and brainwashed to be a ruthless killer, eventually breaking away from the brainwashing, but now with the ability to kill. He decides to use this newfound ability to protect his friends and family, and also has to kill his mentor slash father figure at the end. If it was intentional, that's cool, but I think it's just some random thing that was there when they filmed it. Back to the story. As Kate is about to kill the guy, her head starts to hurt and she misses the shot. She tries to hunt down the target through the rooftops, but her aim isn't good enough. Kate leaves everything behind, steals the car, and starts fleeing from the target's bodyguard. The car can be found in the beginning of every round in the game, and any does comment that the car should actually be completely crushed. The car chase is clearly CGI, and as someone that plays a lot of games, I did like it. It isn't immediately noticeable, but cars seem to lack weight. Towards the beginning of the car chase, one car is ramming another, but they barely move forward. I assume it is done to make the camera chase more clear, but it looks weird at second glance. One thing that took me out of the scene was the constant cutting towards the interior of the car. Instead of having just one long-running CGI scene, for some reason it keeps cutting back to Kate. It makes sense towards the end of the scene where her head starts to hurt, causing her to crash, but I don't like how the beginning of the car chase is cut. Also, right before the car chase starts, there's a jump cut, and as someone that tries to hide cuts as much as possible, I find that really strange for a full-fledged movie. These scenes scenes starting with Kate going on a run and ending with her crashing the car are basically a repetition of the first 5 minutes, with the benefit that it actually transitions into the next story beat and actually sets up the rest of the movie. The first 5 minutes are completely detached from the rest of the movie. The more I think about it, the more I'm convinced that the whole prologue should have been cut out entirely. Anyways, after the crash, we get a flashback where we see a bunch of scenes where V is talking to a younger version of Kate and basically teaching her the craft. Throughout the movie, there will be 3 more flashbacks besides this one, and I don't like them. One is right after she finds out that she has been poisoned, another flashback once Kate decides to kidnap Annie, showing Annie screaming holding her dad's dead body, and one right before the ending where V says that a shot to the head is professional and a shot to the stomach means that it's personal. The poison flashback is a bit too close to the other flashback we just had. The Annie flashback would have made sense if the first 5 minutes of the movie didn't exist, and the V flashback should have been lumped together with the first flashback. While I don't like flashbacks, I think the first one makes sense, and the other 3 major ones are way too on the nose and break the flow of the movie. Especially at the end when we get the random flashback just to explain why Kate is shooting V in the stomach. I would have appreciated it way more if they had set up now and paid it off at the end of the movie, giving the attentive viewer a wink and a nudge. So, Kate wakes up in the hospital and finds out that she's been poisoned with polonium 204. She has roughly a day to live or so.
Polonium 210, not 204, is often used to assassinate people, but rest assured, you will die pretty quickly if you're exposed to any of those elements. There's basically no chance you will be getting up from that hospital bed, and there is no cure for radiation poisoning as of 2021. You will have to suspend your disbelief here, but it sets up the stake nicely. Kate has roughly 24 hours to kill the guy that poisoned her, and so Kate leaves the hospital and makes a visit to the guy that she earlier on had sex with, named Steven.
Turns out the guy was blackmailed by the Kijima clan, specifically Sato, and so Kate gets her first target. She takes some drugs, as you do when you die from radiation poisoning, and the thing she asks for is
Boom Boom Lemon.
I don't quite understand the whole Boom Boom Lemon thing. Is it supposed to be a joke? A tick that Kate has? Does the Boom Boom Lemon represent something to Kate? There's a small payoff at the end that I don't really like, but we will talk about it later. In the game, you can also find Boom Boom Lemon as an upgrade to Kate's stamina. Steven's girlfriend, Snape Kanako, also drops the term collateral damage, which makes me believe that this at some point was a subtitle for the movie or the movie title itself. Kate talks one last time to V. There she finds out that Sato hangs out in a place called Black Lizard. She infiltrates that place and basically kills everyone in there. The game, on the other hand, ends the tutorial with Kate waking up in the hospital, talking to the doc and fighting her way out of the room. We get immediately booted to the main menu, and after starting the game, you find yourself in the front of the Black Lizard, with V parking the vanilla truck from the very beginning of the movie and serving as an upgrade station. Following the movie, we are in the Black Lizard to kill Sato, who is the first boss, but here he is actually called Charlie Brown. Charlie is the second easiest boss, but what makes this fight difficult is the stamina system. As we already know, Kate is dying from polonium poisoning, and the only thing that is keeping her alive are stims. Gameplay-wise, that means the moment she stops slashing through grunts, her health slowly ticks down, indicated by the timer at the top of the screen. It doesn't matter if you're shooting the enemy or taking their heads off, this timer will tick down shortly after you stop killing or attacking. This is the major hurdle that the game throws at the player, and it takes some time to get used to, but the moment it clicks in your head, you'll find yourself in the zone where you're picking up weapons, throwing them, catching the next weapon, shooting and repeating the cycle like a dance of death. Or you could hold on to the shotgun and kill the boss in 1 or 2 rotations. As you can see, the game is not perfect. While it was fun to play, the first boss is very underwhelming, especially when you compare it to Akane, where the bosses were extremely brutal. I didn't even know you could dodge in this game for the longest time, because I never needed it, compared to Akane, where you needed to learn how to dodge immediately to even have a chance against bosses. The fights themselves translate really well from the movie into the game. Of course, putting them side by side, they look nothing alike, but it's more about how they feel.
So, let's have a quick glance at the fight scene near the Black Lizard. And by the way, I really like the fight scenes. And I think this is where the movie shines. Also, the movie doesn't fall into the trap of making the protagonist a Superman. Most kills are either done with a weapon or with the environment. And Kate is always fighting people that have the same stature as her. There are some things that I don't like, and I think are a little bit weird. For example, the fight in the Black Lizard starts when Kate's gun jams and the guys surrounding her grab their knives. Instead of having a one-shot scene where they fight from left to right, we have several cuts showing the guys taking up the knives, wide shot showing them attacking, close shot from Kate's perspective, wide shot again of Kate breaking this guy's leg, shot from the henchman's perspective, as another guy is attacking, we get another cut, but now from the left side of the henchman to show the guy in the front attacking Kate, yet another cut of Kate kicking the henchman, and finally a cut of him flying away. This whole fight is in a mix of longer shots and the shorter cuts, which I assume are there to hide the choreography. Not all fights are shot like that, but most of them are a bit of a mixed bag. In the fight scene themselves, there are also some weird things going on. Kate throws a guy to the ground, slaps him, reloads her weapon on his cheek, shoots another guy, meanwhile the guy on the ground is just holding up his knife until Kate takes it away. Similar to the car chase scene, everything goes by pretty fast so that you don't really notice at a first glance, but it could have been done better. At least there are no disappearing knives, am I right, boys? Of course, Kate gets heavy punishment every time she finishes a fight, and that is also mirrored in her physical deterioration throughout the movie. Here's also where Kate cuts her hair off while also cutting a henchman's finger off and stabbing him in the skull. Pretty cool if you ask me. So, after basically murdering everyone there, she lets a single person live who tells that Aini, Kijima's niece, might be able to help, and so Kate kidnaps Aini, who is the girl from the very beginning of the movie. I haven't talked about the quality of the actors that much because I can never really tell what good or bad acting is, especially when we are in the realm of when it's passable. We have two very experienced actors with Woody and Mary, but Aini, played by Miku Patricia Marinu, is noticeably less experienced than the other actors. It doesn't help that this character is written to be annoying. It is already hard to find good child actors, but if you give them shitty dialogue, not even a good actor can save the role. Miku did a fine job as far as I'm concerned. I think it's just the dialogue that annoyed me to no end. Anyways, Aini can't reach Kijima directly, but they can try to talk to Renji, Kijima's right hand. They set up a meeting with Aini as the bargaining chip, Kate restrains Aini in the dirty bathroom, and awaits the meeting. Unfortunately, Aini isn't as valuable as Kate thought she would be, and Shinzo, Renji's underling, is ordered to take out Aini and Kate. A shootout takes place with a few gruesome kills like the one guy getting his face burned off, and another guy getting kicked out of window just to grab a power line and getting electrocuted. Eventually, Aini is able to free herself, and as Shinzo is about to kill her, Kate takes him out together with all his henchmen. We get a short intermission where Kate wants to leave Aini, but they decide to form a team to eventually take out Kijima, which Aini believes to be the culprit that killed her father. Ironic, given that Kate is the one responsible for Aini's dead dad. Here's the one scene where I had to cringe. And I don't know if it was the delivery, the dialogue itself, or a mix of both that made me go,
"This ain't it, Chief!"
As Kate and Aini are talking about revenge and how Kate wants to kill Kijima, Aini says,
"You're a badass killer, motherfucker."
Is that what the kids find cool now? Am I too old for this? Honest question. I just don't know why this specific sentence makes me cringe so hard. Also, the weird thing is that Aini became kind of a groupie of Kate immediately after seeing her kill a bunch of people. Again, ironic, because Kate didn't want to kill people in front of children. And this relationship develops really fast. We went in a span of half an hour from kidnapping to Aini calling her a cancer bitch, to Kate binding Aini in a dirty bathroom, to Aini basically wanting to join Kate's suicide revenge run. It feels really fast. Here's also where Kate gets her signature smiley muscle shirt, by the way.
Aww, so cute on you.
Which you can find in the game as well as an attack speed upgrade. If you think the relationship of Kate and Amy is underdeveloped in the movie, well, in the game it might as well not exist. In the game, we jump the abduction scene completely and go straight to the market where we meet Shinzo as the boss. Shinzo's fight is a bit underwhelming as well. You have to make use of the mobs more since Shinzo uses shotgun, but overall it's just a tad more difficult than the first fight. After killing Shinzo, we make our way to Renji's boyfriend, and this fight is probably the hardest one. There are no grunts spawning, which means that your health will tick down if you don't attack. Jojima also runs faster and swings their knife widely, taking you out in 2 or 3 hits, and even though Jojima tires out after a few seconds, you can't put them down easily since your weapons break fast, the ammo count is slow, and you run out of stamina quickly. There's one technique here from Akane called the slash and dash, which helps you a lot. If you don't want to abuse this technique though, you can run around the apartment, picking up weapons to either shoot or throw at him, and it does capture the movie scene pretty well. Or you can just grab the infinite ammo upgrade and shoot Jojima to death with a shotgun. Like I said, it's not perfect. Again, the game heavily deviates from the movie here. After killing Shinzo, Kate and Amy do indeed visit Jojima, but it's a 1v2 fight. Kate does this annoying thing of walking towards the target with a gun, closing the distance between you and the target, basically nullifying the advantage a gun provides. And I do think it's fixable. We have Amy here, so why not have Jojima take Amy as a hostage with a knife and command Kate to drop her weapon. Now they don't need Amy to be a complete moron to press the wrong button on the remote, which triggers the music, which distracts Kate, allowing Jojima to disarm her. Unlike this bullshit setup, I really like the fight. It makes use of the environment with both opponents taking whatever is available trying to kill each other. There's one specific part where Kate takes two wine glasses, breaking them, making them into stakes, which I found extremely cool. Surprisingly enough, Kate actually loses the fight, and it is Amy that domes Jojima over the head, killing him in the process. Understandably, Amy fucking loses it, but Kate calms her down as V once calmed her down, mirroring Amy's and Kate's evolution. Except, I just made it up. Not Kate calming Amy down, I mean V calming Kate down. Anyways. If in the beginning flashback we were shown three major things, like 1, V showing her how to box, 2, V calming her down after a kill, and 3, that a shot to the head is professional and a shot to the stomach is personal, we could have the first payoff in the Black Lizard, the second one here, and the third one towards the end.
Yes, I am still talking about flashbacks because I fucking hate them. They can be used effectively in some cases, but most of the time it's used as exposition only and nothing more. Scott, Scott, yeah!
They eventually find out they can track Renji through Jojima's phone and extract location of Akijima's whereabouts. We get another amazing scene where Amy stops Renji's car in the middle of the road. Amy points her hand like a gun towards the driver, presses the imaginary trigger, and a bullet actually hits him. This is stupid, but I love it.
So, we finally get the location for the final big boss 1 hour into the movie, and there's more than half an hour still to go. Weird, isn't it? The location of the final boss is a house in the middle of nowhere, with no guards. The head of a Yakuza family has a house where there are zero guards. I repeat, the head of a Yakuza family has a house with zero guards and an open gate. I repeat, the head of a Yakuza family has a house with zero guards, an open gate, and recently someone tried to kill them. I really want to like this movie, and I do, but if you pull shit like this, not even I can overlook it. But the movie doesn't care, and it doesn't matter anyways. It turns out that Kojima had nothing to do with Kate's poisoning. She was just a tool being used by Varric to get rid of his opponents. She thought V was a family, but in reality, he was working with Renji to take out Amy's dad and become Kojima's right-hand man. And Renji poisoned Kate because he assumed that the moment she retired, she might be a threat to the whole operation, and V did mention that she would have been executed anyway if she left the organization. So both Kojima and Kate got betrayed by their respective families.
Kate, even after hearing all of this, says that she needs to end this, and so Kijima turns around, Kate points a gun to his head, and we cut to Annie talking to V as she finds out that Kate is the one who killed her father. We hear a gunshot and we see Kate leaving the building. In anger, Annie shoots Kate and drives away with V.
So, two things. First, we will talk about Kate and V, and then we're going to talk about Annie. Varric is a bad guy. Should be pretty clear, right? He wants Kijima gone, and apparently that one night was the rare occasion to see him out in the open, which is why Kate was ordered to kill him. But Kijima, in the beginning of the movie, is sitting right there with an open window. Why not kill him then? Kate has an open shot! And at this point, what is V's business anyway? Is he a drug lord, a weapons dealer, a money shark, or an assassin for hire business? Are there more Kates? Also, wouldn't you make 100% sure that the very capable assassin is 100% dead, as well as the target that you want to kill in the first place? You better double tap that shiz ASAP. I can almost overlook all of this because we do hear the gunshot, so V assumes Kijima is dead, and Annie does shoot Kate, and Kate falls to the ground, so there's at least an explanation for some of my questions, but definitely not all of them. So, now, Annie. Annie should question a little bit what is going on here. Why does V know that Kate killed her father? Who is V? Why does V know her? Isn't it weird that suddenly V knows where they are, and yet she believes everything V says, shoots Kate, and jumps into the car with him? Because, again, I don't like the setup. You can still have V telling Annie that Kate killed her father, but in a different order. It would have been better for V to just kidnap Annie, point a gun at Kate, and as she's struggling to save Annie from V's clutches, he shoots her, barely missing, and she collapses to the ground. Same place, same people, but now Kate has a bigger reason to kill V, as he tried to kill her, and she wants to save Annie from V. V and Annie drive away, and V tells Annie that Kate killed her father, even though he told her not to. I'm setting it up like this, because later on, Annie's taken to where Renji meets up with V, and V mentions that she is his future, so I am assuming he wants her to be the next Kate. And yet again, I don't understand the scene where V and Renji and in front of Annie, talk openly about Kate being V's girl. If V wants Annie to be the next Kate, why the fuck would he talk about Kate in front of Annie, basically revealing that he is responsible for the assassination of Annie's dad? These last scenes are very confusing, and while I like the action, I don't like the story.
This whole section with finding Renji, meeting up with Kojima, and V taking Annie away is completely skipped. We never meet Renji as a boss, basically skipping the whole information extraction scene where Annie does the whole finger gun thing. We never meet Kojima, and Annie is never taken away, even though in the game she's not available for the last section. Instead, you need to survive a horde of enemies storming your apartment, which is not easy if you haven't mastered the Dance of Death yet. After that, we get the recreation of the scene where Kojima cuts Renji's head off, and the enemies become more aggressive and their weapons more deadly. And finally, after cutting through all of those enemies, you reach the boss himself. The guy that forced Kate to kill a dude in front of a child. The guy that probably killed her family and made her into an assassin. The mastermind behind all of this.
Defender.
And before we conclude the game, let's rewind back and see how the movie goes. Kate gets up one last time. Kijima hands her a stem. They drive to where V and Kijima are. And on the drive there, Kate finally gets her boom boom lemon. And I think that's the wrong place to give her that, but we will talk about it in a moment. We get this amazing entrance where Kate walks into a room smoking a cigarette, music blasting in the background, and behind her a wing of soldiers start shooting. We see Kate's bruised face, her bloodshot eyes, and her skin basically covered in cancer. Like I said, I think the action scenes are where the movie truly shines, but the costume and makeup department are also really good. I just want to highlight some of my favorite parts here. There's one scene where the lights go out and suddenly we see a bunch of green lasers appearing everywhere. Another one where Kate and the shooter are out of ammo and they both fumble with their guns, but Kate gets him first. Of course, we can't forget the scene where Renji and Kijima have a sword fight and Renji just loses his head. And finally, Kate meets V, who is holding Amy hostage. With her last bullet, Kate shoots V in the stomach, giving him the clear message that this was personal. Blink and you miss it, but V also shoots Kate in the stomach, basically as a counter to Kate's accusation that V only loves himself. In this case, actions spoke louder than words. As V is dying, V says that that was a great shot, which would have been a great payoff if the flashback wasn't right before the scene. The movie ends with Kate being carried out of the balcony by Amy and eventually dying from her poisoning.
Her revenge has been completed. Her sins have been forgiven. The killer has finally grown morals. Kinda. I mean, she killed a lot of people. Those people probably had families, partners, childrens, mothers, fathers, aunts, uncles, grandpas, grandmas, cousins, brothers, sisters, friends, co-workers, you know. So moral in the sense of that two negatives make one positive. While the ending of the movie is a bit underwhelming, I think the game translation might be even worse.
In the game, you kill V with a few bullets, both of you go down, and the game ends. I know that the final boss is supposed to be an anti-climax, still it could have been translated to fit the style of the game more rather than following the movie. The game already takes a lot of creative liberties, so why not make it more fun instead?
I think all the messages we want to extract from the movie are probably excuses to move from one action scene to another, and I think that's lazy. Yet, I really liked the movie. I like the actors, I like the action scenes, I like the idea of the assassin seeking revenge, similar to something like John Wick. There are some things that I really like, and there are some things that I really don't like, especially towards the end of the movie, but generally speaking, I really enjoyed everything I saw. I never expected a movie that I randomly discovered to have a game made by people I actually have talked before. When I made the Akane review, I interviewed the developers from that studio, and it was interesting because they are Brazilian and the developers are operating from the Amazons. It is also quite strange how close the game captures the feeling of the movie. When I was playing, I really thought this was a good translation of the action scenes. The story could have been a bit more fleshed out in the game, since we basically just get short dialogue boxes, but Ludic has never been big on story. The pixel art is fucking fabulous, Kate looks amazing, V looks like a proper bad guy, Renji's boyfriend Jujima is freaking gorgeous, and even generic henchman Charlie Brown looks fucking great. I love this style already, but the boys at Ludic Studio really know their craft. It took me roughly 2 hours to get to the final boss because I had experience with this game type before. I can imagine people that never played an arcade shooter before being frustrated at difficulty, and people that are way better than me being able to knock this game out in the first try. So depending on how good you are, you can get 2 hours out of this or 5 minutes, because that's literally how short one of the fastest run is. The movie itself is surprisingly fun, there's stuff I really like and there's stuff I really don't like. The action scenes are done very well, even though there are occasions where it seems that they had to cut around the action, as I've shown earlier. And one thing that I really appreciate is that this movie is final. There is no stinger, no sequel setup, no franchise. I can enjoy the game and the movie as one complete package, and I shouldn't praise them for it, but in a world where everything has to become a franchise and driven into the ground, I'm happy to have something that has a beginning, a middle, and an end. Like this video! And if you enjoyed the journey so far, give me money on Patreon, or I'm gonna burn your face off. As always, take care of yourselves, and have a nice, wonderful day.